Aaron Rosen, professor of religion and visual culture and director of the Henry Luce III Center for the Arts and Religion at Wesley Theological Seminary. Off in the distance is Klaus Ottmann, the director, deputy director of academic affairs and special initiatives at the Phillips Collection, as well as Debra, an independent curator and writer. Welcome. All right.
Oh, good. Ooh, gosh, sound check there. All right. Well, I'll give just a little bit of an introduction, although there's something, that, especially of the audiences that Tobi brings, that it's all like a family reunion anyway. So it's at the risk of sounding like the Olive Garden, if you're here, you're probably already family in some extended sense. But it's just a great pleasure for me. First of all, this is like a debut back into society since I've been living in quasi-isolation in my hermitage up in the coast of Maine. So re-entering here to see real art and real humans, both of them at the same time, has already been a privilege to reawaken the senses. But it's also great to be in discussion with so many people I admire. Of course, I've gotten to know Tobi over many years. The only thing we disagree about is where we met, but I suppose that's like any good couple. There's, you want to tell it differently. I think it was in New York. Tobi thinks it was in Oxford. But Tobi has been with me in my career from the very start. When I was afraid of living artists, and I only wrote with them with tremendous trepidation, Tobi was the first one, and one of the first times we met, he took me to Costco, and it was like one of those publications where you're like, artists, they're just like us. So I thought, okay, if I can buy juice boxes with him at Costco, this is not going to be that hard to interview living artists. Over time, I wrote about Tobi many times, and it was really just so life-giving to me to see that dialogue of trying to really get inside the head of an artist of what it is that they're trying to accomplish, but also trying to push them and trying to find things that they don't see. And so that really helped me develop as a scholar. So it's a privilege to be able to share the stage with Tobi. And Klaus, I was introduced to early on via Tobi, who gives the guest sort of credentializing of everyone. Oh, you got to meet so-and-so. They're amazing. And so you could spend your whole life simply chasing those recommendations of recommendations. And many of you already know Klaus from his accomplishments and his leading work on Yves Klein and so many other artists. And the exhibitions that have been tremendous that he's done at the Phillips Collection, but many other places, and of course, as deputy director of the institution, and really a role model for bridging that academic and curatorial world so elegantly. And Debra Bricker-Balken, I remember Debra's book on Philip Guston's cartoons, which are so relevant. Of course, there's a big, Philip Guston has been in the news nonstop for the last 3 years, ever since he delayed that exhibition. But your work on his cartoons and thinking about Richard Nixon could not be more prescient in this moment, I think. And there's so many other artists that you've written on and that you've curated shows for, including Arthur Dove. And so it's such a, when we were thinking about who would be a great person on this panel, it was just so natural to think that you would be a wonderful part of this discussion to be able to bring all of these different lines of inquiry. And she's just written a fantastic new book on Harold Rosenberg, and which I was going to have you sign, but it was too big to bring on Carry On and JetBlue. But that just shows what an incredible accomplishment it is. It's the titanic work on him. So with that just scattered introduction, I'd like to jump right in to our discussion. And it's a very curious day to be having a panel discussion because it's Mother's Day. It's also Tobi's birthday.
I love mothers.
Thank you for taking such a controversial stance. That's so edgy of you. Very avant-garde. But it being Mother's Day, I wondered if you might just share a little bit about your mother. And one of the things that you mentioned early on is your mother would have loved to see your work at Wesley, where many of us, I hope, will migrate at 4 p.m. But these works at the Phillips Collection, and love to have seen the arc of your career and those works. And I wonder if you just might talk about what you would see in these works.
Well, first of all, I had the perfect mother. I mean, that's the best way to start. Quite a few of you knew my mother. And, you know, I grew up, I'm a child of Holocaust survivors. I'm named for my uncle, who was the first person killed by Hitler, a Jew killed by Hitler in 1933. But I grew up in Washington Heights, where everyone I knew were children of survivors. And people say, was that depressing? I go, no, it's just a fact. It was just part of who I was and how I grew up. But my mother was the most optimistic, positive person you could possibly meet. And she didn't believe in negativity. You know, she'd always try and find, she'd always say, if the door closes, then a window opens. She would love that I was having this show on Mother's Day and my birthday at the Phillips. The way Duncan Phillips collected is every artist's dream. I like other museums. I'm not going to put down any other museums because I know this is live streamed, and I'm a grown up, and I know what I'm doing. But you know, for an artist to understand that it's not about the single painting or sculpture or ceremonial object you make, but you're on a trajectory, and you're trying to make work that is important at the time that you do it, but you also want to make art for all of your life. And I can't believe, as I told Klaus, when the Phillips got a piece of mine from 1977, that you just gave me back 8 years of my life. And I don't remember, I said that to you, I said, everyone knows my work from the Guggenheim show, which was in 85. And all of a sudden, there's a piece here that I did when I was in graduate school at Pratt Institute. And I was always, all my work is based on photographs, and I got my BFA in photography. I studied with Roy de Carava and Mark Felstein. And in the short video that they did for this presentation, I talked about the fact that my mom, I was 6 years old or seven, we lived in Washington Heights, and there was a building across the street from us, and I would sit on the radiator, and I would look at this, you know, the bricks on the building, and I'd say, Mom came by the room and said, what are you doing? And I said, look at that. She goes, look at what? And I said, look, you see how the bricks change colors when it's wet and when it's dry and when it's sunny? And she pulled over a chair, as every, I think, great mother does. And she goes, let me see it. And she looked at it and she goes, I never thought of it that way, but wow, that's really interesting. And the first show that the Phillips has of mine is from my studio in Pratt, where I look through a window. And it was one of those crisscross glass windows that you can't see through, but you see the light that comes through. And so I think my mother would have thought to herself, like, I'm 6 years old, you pulled it off. You know what I mean? Like, so thank you, Klaus, for accepting that painting in the collection. But I think she would have been over the moon too. My sister's a poet who flew in from Israel for today. And she just wanted us to do whatever we wanted to do. And so since it is Mother's Day, I want to thank every mother who gave their children the understanding that your dream is their dream and you should follow your dreams.
Oh, that's lovely, Toby. And it's a great sort of, that window imagery is a great portal for the rest of our discussion. And that work, I had never seen that work before, and so it was a real revelation to me. And really put you in dialogue with works by Rauschenberg and a lot of the monochromes that are so important in the Phillips collection. Klaus, do you want to talk a little bit about what your strategy was for taking on certain works by Tobi, what you were looking for, and how that resonates with the Phillips strategy?
Yeah, sure. So there's a number of things that one can say about Duncan Phillips and what makes him so unique and his collections so unique. Two things that are very important were the idea of the conversation, that he always felt that art needs to be in conversation with each other, and art from different generations, you know, art by contemporary artists with historical artists and so forth, abstract with figurative, photograph with paintings and so forth. And the other one was the idea of units. So, and he was one of the first people who really felt that it made more sense to collect an artist in depth and follow them throughout their career and create what he called units. And the first one that he created was Pompocly. And he also was very early on created a Paul Klee room. It wasn't permanent, but it was something he put up for a while and then took it down. And then it ultimately, he ended up with the Rothko room, which of course was is now a permanent collection. The same idea in a way. So I started with the Phillips in 2010 as curator, and Tobin and I are neighbors in New York, so. So we
what
knew it's
great for me.
And at some point he knocked on the door and he said basically, there's a painting that could be available for the Phillips collection if you guys want it. So and I thought this would be really wonderful because again the idea of conversation and how his work really has a sort of a conversation with so many artists in our collection, especially the American modernists like Hartley, Marston Hartley, or Albert Dove and others. So I thought this would be perfect. So I proposed it and to our board, and it was accepted. And little did I know that in about 10 years later, we ended up with a real unit in the spirit of Duncan Phillips of seven works. That pretty much covers almost your entire career. It really is like a miniature perspective, right? So that's really wonderful. And actually, this installation that's upstairs is kind of one of my last tasks as a curator. I stepped down as chief curator 2 months ago, and I was in charge of doing the reinstallation of the collection. And suddenly I realized, we have seven works by Tobi Kahn and nobody's ever seen them all together. And actually most people in the museum probably didn't even realize that we have them made. So I decided to hang them. I thought they fit perfectly into this fun little gallery. And it kind of got a life of its own. So very, very pleased with that.
Yeah, they really resonate with one another. Maybe that's a nice point to leap off from, thinking about these different units and people represented in the Phillips. And really, it's just one of my favorite museums in the world. I absolutely love it. Maybe, Debra, you could talk about some of the artists that are represented in the Phillips, but just as a way, thinking about some of the folks that Klaus just mentioned, Dove and Hartley, and maybe kind of situate Toby's work against some of these other units. If you were to kind of complete the puzzle, how would you sort of see Toby against some of these, or in conversation with some of these other 20th century painters?
Well, definitely I see your work in conversation with Arthur Dodd. And by the way, Duncan Phillips was somebody who collected Arthur Dove in depth, too. I think you have almost 42 Doves in your collection. And Dove could not have existed without Duncan Phillips' patronage during the Great Depression. It was essential for him.
Yeah, he gave him basically a monthly stipend to really nurture him. And that's why he ended up with so many.
Right. But, we were talking, Aaron and I were talking earlier about, a seminal text that emerges in this country in 1914, and that's Kandinsky's Concerning the Spiritual and All. And it was a text that the Dove read in depth, and I think also when that text appears is a critical turning point in the work of Arthur Dove. He's not that prolific as an artist during the decade of the tens. He's working as a chicken farmer in Connecticut at the time, and art, for the most part, drops out of his life. But still, he read and reread that text. And
as
did you, I would imagine, yeah. And so it's one of the first times that we find, I think, in the early 20th century, the use of this word spiritual. And, what does spiritual really mean? I mean, in terms of Kandinsky, spiritual meant, first of all, an opposition to a growing materialist culture within this country. But as a result of that, Kandinsky's advice and prescriptions for the artist was to draw on their inner lives, to draw on their subjective selves, as a way of also engaging in advancing the languages of abstraction. So that the more abstract a painting became, the more it resists this notion of this looming materialist culture. So untethered from religion, but still there is this core emphasis on the elaboration of one's emotional life.
Go ahead, Toby.
I was going to say that it's people like Duncan Phillips that helps artists become who they want. And I have to say, all of my career, I've been blessed by the most amazing patrons that enabled me to do the same. Jane Black, for others, I've been blessed with so many. In fact, you're going to see works, all the works in the collection were given by these fantastic friend patrons of mine. And they had works of mine for 10 or 20 years, and then they'd say, you know, we're moving, or is there a museum you'd like the work to go to? And I always, when it was my favorite works, I'd say, to Phillips. I mean, definitely, let me show it to the Phillips, and if they don't want it, I know there are other museums that will want it, but let's try. And, you know, you said to me, Klaus, they're such good work. I feel I pick things that I adore, that I wanted to be together, and I'm very lucky with the patrons, and I don't even know what to say, and if it weren't for Duncan Phillips, then Arthur Dove couldn't have continued that way, and if it weren't for my patrons, there's no way I'd have the career that I have, that I'm able to do work that I am so proud of, that I want to do. My wife and kids are here, and I love going to my studio. I feel that is my home, and to give an opportunity to an artist to dream out loud is what great collectors and patrons can do. And most of the artists that I admire always had patrons that enabled them to do that, so they didn't have to worry about the fact that if you do one great painting and then 10 people say to you, we want the exact same one, then you don't grow. And I think being able to just keep on dreaming is every artist's fantasy, and I can't say how lucky I feel for that.
So maybe there's a spirituality in collecting and being a patron as well as being an artist. It reminds me of Emmanuel Levinas, sort of returning to one of his rabbi's advice, a piece of advice that the material needs of the other are my spiritual needs, and so providing the sustenance for the artist in these times, especially difficult times like we've just been going through for artists, can meet a spiritual need. Yeah, go ahead.
There is another aspect of why I felt Toby's work was so perfect for the Phillips Collection, and that goes back to the founding of our museum. And, you know, this museum was founded in 1921 in the midst of another pandemic, or just after another pandemic, the so-called Spanish flu. And Duncan Phillips's brother died of the Spanish flu, and his father died of another sickness, but shortly thereafter. And he was so grief-stricken, and he had this profound experience when he looked at the art that he had started to collect. He felt that the art helped him get over this immense grief that he had. And it created this profound belief in the restorative power of art. And that's what motivated him to open his house to the public and basically to create a museum, because he wanted his community to have to be able to have the same experience, to share that with his community. And what I also find so remarkable about Toby's work is that he has this great interest in this idea of well-being and healing. And my entire life I've been attracted to artists, to art that has this kind of spiritual quality. But I've also been always fascinated by religion and art, which I think is a little different. And I think that both art and religion have the same common ground, which is to deal with the fact of life, which is death. And I think it was J. Carr who wrote a book on Poussin, who said that painting is about death. And I really believe that. The work that you do also with the end of life installations and the meditative installations and all the stuff. It's all part of that larger picture of creating a, you know, ethical foundation for making sense of life and towards death. And so I think that's part of that. And I think that's, that was another reason why I think your work fits so well into this collection.
It's interesting how easy it can be to marginalize words like healing, isn't it? That sometimes that can be seen as either too direct or pedagogical or wishy-washy, but actually it's one of the great depth charges of art in the 20th century, as artists who wanted to do that in a very profound way, and especially from a Jewish side, tapping into this, the concepts of Tikkun Olam. Debra, I wondered if you could sort of react a little bit to what Klaus is saying, this citation about art being about death, or, I mean, it's a particular existential reading of religion, because religion has been defined so many different ways in the 20th century, to the point that by the end of the 20th century, most religion scholars just threw their hands up in the air and said, we can't define it. But what is it that you see as key touchstones in religion that 20th and 21st century artists keep coming back to, whether it's the ritual side, the philosophical concerns? What do you think why do you think artists keep circling back? I don't want to say like moths to a flame, but why is it that artists keep coming back to religion to pull things into their work?
Interesting. Well, I guess I would respond to that by naming a couple of artists that I think have dealt with this most directly. And the first of those figures would be Barnett Newman, whose work is not about solely about the advancement of modernist languages and arriving at this very austere, pared-down state, but there's also a distinct metaphysical content to Barnett Newman's work, and he is also somebody that named all of his paintings after either Old or New Testament subjects. But very interestingly, in 1967, he participates at a conference in New York on art and religion, and he begins to question this very term spirituality, and what does spirituality mean? It's become so diluted by 1967. We don't have a distinct sense of its meaning, and he throws out surrogate terms that could be used to describe the content of his work, and he ironically arrives at this word soul, because soul is a word that will begin to be circulated in the late 1960s, as he says, primarily through the hippies. But spirituality is something that he also comes right out and says is a dirty word, in part because it's still a taboo subject. And you know, as an art historian, I often wonder, and I have had to contend with, how you deal with an artist's faith when you're writing about their work. A couple of years ago, I did an exhibition, a retrospective on the work of Mark Tobi, and that was something that I had to contend with very, very directly, because he was a member of the Baha'i faith, but he kept his faith and his studio practice very, very separate, in part because I think that he worried in the mid-century that the interpreters of his work would write it off, especially foremost art critics such as Clement Greenberg, who had absolutely no interest in content or subject matter, let alone religion. So his faith was kept quite separate. And it was something, again, that I thought about, how am I going to deal with this? Because it was something that Tobi, you know, didn't encourage his interpreters to follow. But still, if you look at his abstract paintings, these beautiful swarms of light, which represent the Godhead, after all, there are woven these little figures of prophets into the interstices of these networks of line. So to get back to your question about this idea of death, I mean, Barnett Newman is also somebody who predicted the end of death of painting in the late 1940s as he was beginning to work actively as an artist and name his work after Old Testament subjects. The next person would, of course, be someone like Ad Reinhardt.
Pierre Reinhardt is such a, enigmatic statements like Zen poems. I mean, he, of course, in the way, what's great about Reinhardt is that art is not religion, and then he'll go off to say things that sound exactly like statements of art is religion. and sort of, yeah, propose and negate constantly. And maybe that's one of the things that we do see as, you know, as a wider theme through mid-century 20th art, is that this sense of creating and evoking these parallels and then wanting to not own them as fully. Because that, I mean, Newman, when he would speak of it, he would attend an event at the Jewish Museum and then he would write them later in a private note to say, you compromised me by saying I'm a Jewish artist. And I'm like, well, you did agree to go to a panel on Jewish art at the Jewish Museum, so maybe you kind of put yourself in it a little bit. Now, Tobi, I wonder how you have seen, how you have played with these different terms over the course of your career. So since the Phillips has these works from different decades, does that sort of become a memory palace and tie you into different ways you've talked about your painting over time? Were there moments when you felt more comfortable talking about religion, sometimes more confident talking about spirituality, or maybe sometimes neither of those? Are there different times when you've been drawn to different vocabularies?
Well, it depends how, now I'm a grown-up. You know, I'm not in my 20s anymore, my 30s or my 40s. So when I was very young, I've always believed this saying called Selam Elokim, that everyone is made in the image of God, which I still totally believe in. I think every human being is in the spirit of God, 100%. I see myself as an artist. I happen to be very proudly Jewish, child of Holocaust survivors, very proud of my amazing wife and children. I love that all as part of my life, but I do believe I was made to be on this planet to make art. And I believe that the art that I make should be healing and meditative. You know, I'm named after my uncle who was a medical student. I take that very seriously. He was killed at the age of 21. My dad always said he was a fantastic artist as well. So I'll never forget Peter Sells. I didn't want to show my Jewish ceremonial objects early in my life because everyone would always say, oh, you're an observant Jew? Do you make ceremonial objects? And I do, but I would say, like, I'm a painter, I'm a sculptor, I've got a BFA in photography. So I didn't say no, but I didn't answer the question. But as I got older, Peter said to me, I'll never forget this, it was over 30 years ago, he came to my studio and he said, you know, your shrines and your paintings and your ceremonial objects are coming out of the same human being. You should be proud of everything you do. And it was like a light that went off in my life. And I was like, you're right. Yeah, I'm very proud of everything I do, but I don't believe any of my work is more religious than anything else. I can't separate. I studied in Jewish day school for 12 years. Then I studied in a seminary in Israel for 3 years. And I went to art school. I got my BFA in photography and printmaking, my MFA in painting and sculpture. I can't separate color theory of Joseph Albers from what Tehillah is, which is a Jewish biblical color, which is blue, which goes, and people always say to me, you use blue so often. Did you like Eve Klein? I said, I love Eve Klein, but that's not why I use blue. I love Tehillah. You know, Tehillah is this beautiful bluish color that goes from the best way to describe it is it comes from either a snail or from a fish, and it comes out of the animal clear, and then it goes through the whole color spectrum, and it ends on this bluish purple color. Conceptually, I just love that a color can change. And
you should have trademarked it, like International Klein Blue. There would have been a good
move. Rembrandt Green. There are a lot of artists that say, no, I want this for the whole world. You can all have talent. It's yours. Happy birthday. I see myself as a person of faith. I do believe in God deeply, but I wouldn't want to be defined that way. I like what you said, Klaus. I make art that is healing. You know, every artist has a dream of what he, she, or they do. My dream is that after you see my work, it makes you feel better about yourself. And I don't believe art is made by the artist for themselves. I make art to be seen, and I can't tell you how lucky I feel that I've met any collectors that I know of, and there are quite a few in the audience, who put myself in storage. I like that my work is being seen. I want there to be a dialogue. I want you to see it differently if it's a Monday or a Wednesday. Not that I think Monday or Wednesday, but you come into the room, you look at it, and it meets you in a different way because you're a different person that day. You know, I'm not against artists who are purely political. It's just not what I want to do with my life. I think a lot about when I create a piece of art, what's going to happen to it. And being at the Phillips and seeing from 1977, that's more than a month ago, and seeing how much the work changed, and seeing that it still looks like my work. It was like fun to meet my early paintings again. You know, it's, this was my fantasy. If you ever say, like, what was your fantasy as an artist? I want to make art till the minute I die. And Nessa, my wife, once told me, she was at a panel discussion once, and they were talking about life and death. And the person asked, how many of you realize you're going to die one day, and only half the audience raised their hand? And I went, like, oh, my, yeah. So everyone is born, but we're all going to eventually die. And I think the most important thing is to leave the world a better place than you entered it. And if it can be for me by making art, that's all I ever wanted to do. Did I answer your question?
Does it matter if you answer?
No.
I mean,
I'm a good boy. I'm a younger child. So
they give you a grade on that?
Yeah. That's very beautiful. I think since you bring up this point that a lot of art is very identity driven now, very political, I see this all the time where, I was hanging a work a few years ago by an Israeli artist, and someone said, you shouldn't hang that there because it's, because the image is of a white woman and her son. And I said, right, and she happens to be an Israeli woman with her son, and you can just see from behind staring into this blank void. So it seems to be a fairly existential dilemma that might be in common with many people. But it was a real striking moment of thinking for me of what inclusivity looks like in different contexts, how to balance things, how to make sure things are approachable, but also how to acknowledge that artists, whoever they are, coming out of very different cultural contexts and ethnic backgrounds, linguistic backgrounds, that they're talking to their experience. And we have to also find ways to embrace that across the spectrum of people. So it strikes me that, apropos this kind of anecdote, that, you've been making a lot of images of the human body right now, and there might have been a time in the early 20th century or the late 19th century where people would have said, that's the least political thing you could do. You're doing no one really thought of Ong doing Odalisque, now we see them in a completely different Orientalist light, right? But no one, we might not have seen those as political, but by making bodies right now, like the show that we have up at Wesley, and you can see one of your body works up here, is that that you are putting yourself out there in a slightly different way than you have with some of the other works that might be have more macrocosmic or microcosmic or landscape thing dimensions to them. How do you see yourself when you're making bodies? How do you negotiate that realm where things might start to get a little bit fuzzy? I know you're what kind of people do you use as models? How do you engage with them? What do you talk about when you're in studio with them? Tell us a little bit about that, and I want to bring Klaus and Debra into that. So every painting I've ever made is because something happens to me. So one day I had a student come in, I teach at the School of Visual Arts, and one of my students was taking a class. She came from Switzerland. She was a film student, and she was doing films on dancers. And she said to me, I've never liked my body, but I love doing film projects with dancers. Do you understand what I mean? And I went, like, no, explain a little more. She goes, well, I don't look like my dancers look. I said, well, let's start this semester. She was a transfer student for a semester. Let's every week get different dancers to come in, and I decided I wanted dancers from the age of 30 to 70, all different sizes and shapes, and all different ethnicities. That was really important to me. And first week we started, my students say to me, well, so the beginning, so it's a long pose. It's a six-hour class, long pose, but the first 10 minutes I have the dancers come in. I always have the dancers talk to my students and tell them about themselves, because I don't believe it's good for a student to just say, move your arm, do this, do that. I said, you should talk to them. They should know who you are. Tell them about your life other than modeling first. And then I said, why don't you all do quick sketches? And they said, well, what do you mean by quick sketches? I said, fine. I'll take some photographs. I'll show you the images. And they all are going like, wow, these are great. Can we use them? I said, it's a teaching class. Of course you can use them. As I took them, I was like, wow, these shapes look amazing. And then it started very slowly. You should know early in my career, I did do images of dancers. I always have loved dancers. And when I looked at them, I realized that moment of when a dancer moves like this or moves like that, it becomes a whole universe. And it looked to me so much like landscape. And then as this was a three-year project, and as it continued, I realized a lot of trans students and a lot of gender fluid students. And I started realizing that some of the models were that also. And I would say to them, tell me how you want to see yourself. And then those images, 3 years of images, became the body for this exhibition. And I see them as continuity for my landscapes, because everything I do, I'm trying to show that moment of clarity. You know, people have said, why don't you show the photographs next to the paintings? And I said, that's not what it's about. It's about that 1 second when you see it. If you think about Edward Weston, that famous photograph of Dunes, there's a great show at MoMA. It was called Outtakes. And you look, so for me, looking at those models, and I love Pina Bausch. I don't know if you know Pina Bausch, great work. And one of the models was 70 years old, and she was a dancer for Pina Bausch. And she's in so many of the images, because she loved her body and was so relaxed. And that's what I found most interesting. And I also found riveting how people at different stages of their life, I'm not talking about age, I'm talking about people, one of my dancers became a doctor. And it was so interesting to watch them move. So I never did images based on long poses. I own all the photographs I took were working with models who did those movements for 10 seconds and no more. So, yeah, that was very powerful.
Debra, what do you think about, when you mentioned, apropos spirituality, a number of artists, so many of them were abstractionists that were using language of spirituality or the sublime and things like this. Do you think there's more opening now to talk about spirituality in relationship to the body? Do you see that becoming a bigger theme in contemporary art?
It's a more omnipresent theme than it was mid-century or even at the turn of the 20th century. But I'm not sure that it's a predominant theme.
Yeah, I agree
with you.
Yeah. Klaus, what do you think about, so let's ask a kind of synoptic question. You said you're stepping down from being chief curator and, it comes at such an interesting time in the art world. Can you sort of give us this, and you've always been interested in religion and in spirituality and many of these different cultural moments that you've tapped for exhibitions. Where do you see things going right now? Where do you see the most interesting things that are about spirituality taking place? Is it things that are spirituality is seen either through the body or through the index of politics? Where is the most gripping stuff being produced, aside from Tobi's work, or in dialogue with Tobi?
Well, I don't know. That's a very difficult question.
That's why I didn't ask it myself.
I think there's so many things now that are possible now for artists that were not possible in the past. And there's a lot of new and interesting things happening. But one thing, I can't really answer that, but in relation to what we're talking about, I think that there has been for a long time this you're going to call it, taboo of religion and art or spiritual religion. Right. I think that is resolving. That is kind of becoming less, you know, I think it's there is a great, I do see a lot of artists dealing more consciously with these issues, and I think there's more acceptance of that, and I think that's definitely something that I feel is going on. But there's so many other, you know.
Right, it's hard to pick a dominant. Yeah, something, things are almost exploding in every direction all at once, and so it's hard to pick. These meta-narratives no longer exist in the same dominant way. I mean, one thing I've noticed in interviewing contemporary artists for Image Journal is that I'll ask artists now, do you have a ritual practice? And I don't think I would have asked that question if I were in another era necessarily, and I'm not sure the artist would have answered that. I think that more artists are willing to talk about their sort of personal practices and see some sort of dialogue there. I mean, but it was interesting, Tobi, how you talked about, literally in the same breath, since it's you, your family and then the studio, but you sort of presented those as two realms, right? If you're thinking about your sacred shrine-like works, it's like two shrines, and you sort of go back and forth kind of between those. But do you see a ritual practice that sort of crosses those boundaries? Are there things that you do in the studio that remind you of the things you do in a domestic religious sphere? Do you see any crossover there, or do you really see them as more bifurcated?
No, I think it's the same breath. I mean, I breathe every day, and I think all of those things are part of me. I certainly don't see my family practice, my artistic practice, and my religious practice as three different things. I feel like I want to make art, but I don't want to make art without having a family. And I the art that I want to make, I want to heal. That's what I believe in. And I always tell people I totally believe in God, but I think everyone has their own God. I don't think there's one right way to do anything. I was so happy, Klaus, that you put that up in the museum, in the unit room, and I believe in Tikkunola. I believe in that we have to, the world is having such a tough time, and I want my work to do that, but I never felt that I wear different hats. I'm just one person, you know, I'm just an artist, you know. I told my wife the other day, you know, I hope I live to be 120, as we say in our faith. But I just want to write on my tombstone, he made art, you know, and I'm very proud of that. I feel it was a gift to be born with something that I knew I wanted to do. I didn't feel, I always tell my students at SVA when they say, well, should we be an artist? I go, like, if you can do anything else, run in the other direction. Don't do anything. I mean, just run, go, because every time I make a piece of art, I'll call Nessa very often. I just finished these two, I'm very proud of them now, two big commissions for Las Vegas, and it was going out on the 6th. The week before, I told Nessa every day, it's not going to get done, it's not going to get done, it's not going to be done. And she said to me, it's going to get done, it's going to get done. I'm going, well, it might not be good, and I don't know if I'll like it. And I'm going through this whole ritual of trying to figure out, is it going to be good? And then 2 days before, it looked like it was good, and I came home on that Sunday, and I said to Nessa, I think I finished them. And I was 2 days early. It was like, whoa. But that, for me, making art is a dream. I can't believe how lucky I am. And people think, do you worry that you won't have another idea tomorrow? And I'm going like, no, I have like 5,000 ideas. And, you know, when you interviewed me and we did this for the film that Susan Dreyfuss did, and I love what she said in the film, he said, you know, you talk to Tobi, and he says to you got to come to the studio and see what I'm doing. But it's real. That's how
right,
I think.
It's real, I think, yeah.
When the painting looks good or the sculpture looks good, I think I'm a genius. When it's bad, ask my family. It's terrible. I'm going, God, it's so bad.
Well, that's one of the spiritual dimensions a lot of artists talk about, is to create something that feels alienated from you. Like, that experience, that's the greatest sensation for many artists, is that how could I have created that? How that thing seems to have come from beyond me. So as we kind of wrap up here and think to moving towards questions from the audience, I just one thing that's come through our discussion has been about healing. But I wonder how everyone might situate that word differently, because I think there's one thing to say that art has healing potential or could heal or we're interested in healing. What does that mean to each of you, that art could be something that heals? I have not prepped them in advance for this, so it's out of the blue. So we'll see how it goes, right?
But can I add one question to that, which I want you to answer too?
Oh, God.
I admire the three of you. I can't believe, I told my kids and my wife on the way, I can't believe I'm on a panel with people I so admire. I'm telling you, I told you so many times, sweetie.
Anyone who knows me, Doug, is like, I mean what I say. If I don't like somebody, just to let you all know, I don't talk to them. I mean, people I don't like, they'll never hear from me. I'm polite.
I'll say, nice to meet you. Thank you. I'm very I just want to ask you, what do you feel like when you write? You write and you write and you write. I would love to be in your brain for a minute. Like, what do you think about? Like, how do you pick your topics? And I want that for all three of you, since I'm allowed to ask a question because I'll go in the audience and make believe I'm in the audience. But I'd love to know how, because I know what happens to me when I'm making art. You guys are brilliant. I'd like to know what's going on in your head.
So you can all.
You can pick from two unanswerable questions. You can choose to answer either Toby's question of what does it feel like to create as a writer and does that resonate with being a painter and a sculptor, or what do you think healing and art means? So I hate to tell you, these are both really nebulous.
No, so I want them to do both.
Oh, that's my birthday.
I'm sorry.
Would you like to volunteer, Doug?
Well, okay, let me try to tackle the second question, because I think the writing process is not that different, actually, from the painting process. And I also believe that even when I'm not seated at my desk and writing, which I try to do, you know, religiously when I'm intensely involved with a project, I'm always working. I'm always thinking about that particular idea and how I'm going to resolve that and how I'm going to rework language and passages of language. So I think that there are real equivalents there. But just this idea about healing, so I'm going to go back to Barnett Newman, and you know, so one of Barnett Newman's primary interpreters was Harold Rosenberg, the mid-century critic who was an existentialist, who also was a literary commentator in addition to becoming an art critic, actually midway through his career. And when he's writing about Newman's work, he talks about how in the 50s, one of the biggest crises within our culture, and crises was a word that was used frequently in the mid-century, but one of the biggest crises for him was the crisis of religion and the crisis of belief, and how belief can be allied with the creative process. And for Newman, that took the form again of advancing languages of art before what we had seen. And, you know, the outcome, not unlike the outcome of Rothko's paintings, and I'm thinking more specifically about the Rothko Chapel, is those pieces are deeply meditative. They're meant to be ruminated on. They're meant to provide, you know, metaphysical, spiritual, or transcendent uplift, whatever phrase or term you want to use. And I don't think that's any different than what you're doing.
that I do believe is exactly what I believe in. I believe that look and look again. It's not a two-minuter. I tell my students all the time, spend more than they say that people at museums look for 3 seconds.
Unless it's a video installation.
What?
Unless it's a video.
Right, and then it's 5 seconds. But you know, whatever. And they say they take more time taking selfies in front of the piece than they do looking at the work. So, I, you know, somebody said to me, how much time do you want somebody to look at my work? I said, give me a minute.
Just a minute.
1 minute. Yeah, no, I agree with you.
And what do you think, Klaus, given especially what maybe this question is feeling in relation to things like the Roth room or the Wolfgang Lab and things that are so amazing?
I'll answer both questions really quickly. So, but about the writing. So I always tell people that I learned how to be a good curator, I think I am, from artists. They taught me how to do a good installation. The same is, in a way, true as a writer. You know, I get all my inspiration as a writer from artists and from poets. Mm-hmm. I think it's very similar. Without you guys, I wouldn't know what to write. So, the other thing, healing, and I feel bad that I didn't give you a really good answer to your complicated question earlier. There is something that's really different, I see, that's going on, which is that we're going from, a lot of artists going away from this kind of traditional model of being solitary artists in the studio to something that's more communal and more collaborative. Mm-hmm. Both in the way, working with other artists or working with communities and being engaged with these communities. Perfect. And it was Yves Klein, in the 60s, who kind of saw this already when he talked about pulling away the veil of the studio and opening up the studio, no more secrets, when he brought all these models in to make the works for him. I mean, it was still the 60s and a lot of issues with that, but he had that vision that art, the future art, is collaborative and it's inclusive. And I think the healing part, it's a little bit about that too. It's very important to be inclusive, to be engaged, and I think that it's not a one-way thing. So that the participatory element, I think, is really important, and that's what also helps, like what we do here and in other places about art education. And we do this with, especially say for the elderly, for instance, or Alzheimer's patients, to get people involved in art and in art activity, and it has great healing potential, and it's done in this kind of participatory community kind of framework.
Yeah, thank you for bringing those strands together so beautifully, because I think that really does touch on something. And here we are as a community discussing things, discussing healing, and that it is not just a solipsistic act of artistic creation or of reception of someone looking at a painting by themselves, but the presence of the Shekinah or the presence of some spiritual aspect that's summoned by looking at things together. And so on that spirit, I think it's well past time to invite questions from the audience.
Can I ask you one favor since you brought, and I asked you so many favors, but I'd love, you asked me to send you some images.
Yes.
I'd really like to go through them quickly because those are all communal. We picked all communal pieces. So if you go to the first one, we'll go through it quickly so I'm not, I don't mean that you shouldn't answer. No, we shouldn't go quickly? I'm good? Okay. So go to the first one.
They're only going to be late to your party next, so it's fine. It's okay.
But I know that everyone has jobs here. So let's go to the first. Can you go to the beginning? So that I want to talk about that. So these are major installations that I've done that are communal. And I thought that would be a great way to segue to that. So this was my first large outdoor commission in 1993 that was commissioned by Jane Blatter Owen. And I have to tell you the story because it's so great. Any artist in this room always show at museums that are not the biggest museums in the world, because that's great things happen. So I had a show at the museum in St. Louis, and oh, wow, my St. Louis buddy here. And Jane Blatter Owen came and saw a little maquette, it was this big, and she said, "That's beautiful. Somebody should make that large." And I had no idea who she was, and her family was Exxon in Texaco. And I said, "Great, somebody should." And I sat down again, and Jane Dillenberger, who wrote a lot about Barnett Newman, came over to me. I met Peter Stelz that same day, and he said, "You're the luckiest young man ever." I was once very young, too, by the way. She said, "You just met somebody who can make that sculpture, make it happen." And I said, "Who?" And she said, "Do you know who Jane Owen is?" I said, "She seems like a very nice lady, but no." She goes, "You know the Blatter Trust?" And I said, "Of course I know the Blatter Trust." And she said, "She is the Blatter Trust." So I went back to Jane and I said, "Jane, wow, you really want to do this large?" And she gave me her plane. And that happened in 1993. So that was the first large outdoor sculpture. Now I've done over 50, but that's the first thing that means a lot to me. That was done, I was commissioned by Father Walter Smith,
was right after 9/11, and he wanted me to make a meditative space for clergy that were helping people that had died. And it was very important to me that blue, tailored again, blue is sky and water. And I had been working for Joe Papp at the Public Theater and other people, and that's theatrical foam. So when you sat down on the chairs, your body stayed in the space until after you left the space. So the ambient light, this is called Saphir. Saphir is a Jewish ritual object. We are in this period, and I love when people say to me, what's the longest period it took you to make a piece of art? And I said, well, over 40 years. And they go, really? So my bar mitzvah speech was, I talked about this holiday, which is between Passover and Shavuot, which is the Jewish people, we were slaves in Egypt, and we became a free people. And that was my speech. And I woke up Nessa in the middle of the night in my early 40s, and I said, Nessa, I think I figured out how to do this. And she said, must we do this now? And I said, yes, we do. And I have a little piece of wood where I drew everything on, and each piece comes out one at a time, and each piece about refracted and reflected light. So each piece looks good next to each other. And when it was first unveiled, we had the Count from Sesame Street come down with little kids, and the Count would say, oh, what's today? And the kids loved it. So it was an interactive piece, again, building community. Let's go to the next. So this, I'm very proud of, and somebody's here whose mother-in-law made this happen. I hope she's watching, because I love them. People who give an artist a chance to make a holy space is amazing. This is a synagogue where I did, they wanted me to do an installation on creation of the world, and I said, what about just creation? And Barbara, your mother-in-law, love your mother-in-law, she goes, you can do whatever you want. I just want gold, silver, and white. And I said, fine, sounds good to me. So all the paintings are either in gold and white or silver and white. Let's go to the next. This is one of my favorite pieces I've ever done in my life. These I was blessed to have a show with the Albright Knox. And, oh, the Albright Knox. The curator from there is here, too. This is great. And the Neuberger Museum and then the Brower Museum. It went to many museums around the country. This is about, to me, this is pure holiness to me. And if you say to me, what are my most religious pieces of art? It's my sky and water, because we can't live without water and we need air to breathe. So this is a meditative space where you can sit. And I'm very proud that in the NY, there are many hospitals all around the world, in Japan too, of these meditative spaces. This is the newest project I just finished. I'm very happy that the Dean of Jefferson is here too. This is on the on their campus, the East Falls campus, and I was told to make something because it's a medical school. It also has, they design amazing works, and I don't know if any of you know what Cycladic art is. Biggest influence on me is Cycladic art, because I find the work from the Cyclades unbelievable. So they're about the idea of figures and also of tools. And if you look at somebody who I also adore, Giacometti or so many great artists, and Brancusi, who looked at these ancient, anyway, that's that piece. I think that's, oh, this, I was recently commissioned by the MTA and the Port Authority. These are the last two pieces of steel from 9/11. And I was so touched. They called me up and said, we want you to make something out of these two last pieces of steel. And I said, you know, why me? And they said, good, because we know you believe in memorial lights. I've been creating memorial lights for 40 years. And so the one on the left is a memorial light for an individual who died. And if you light a match in that one over there, you get two beams of light coming up. And that is for communal death. And I shrunk what the World Trade Center looked like, and it's a big vessel. And if you go to the 9/11 Museum or the NYU, I just got an email. It's up at the Great Art Center right now. I did an edition of three, and there, one is in the church, one is at the 9/11 Museum, and one is at the Great Art Center. And I think, and this is the show that's up right now, and I really want to thank Aaron for that. These are formation images of the body, and these are all figures of all different age of human beings. And then I think, and that I really want to thank the patron who was kind enough to donate this to the Phillips. It's one of my favorite paintings.
That's it.
Oh, no.
Oh, my God. Another person who made this happen.
Oh, am I late?
This is your last one.
My last one.
Okay. This is
so
okay.
This is the newest piece I've done. It's not been shown to the world yet. And if you come to New York, I hope you come to see it. It's at the JCC on the west side. And it's a Soka and a meditative space. And Klaus, thank you for telling me to include it. I just photographed this, but this photograph is not as good as the rest of them. But this is there's a Jewish holiday called Sukkot. It's when you're in nature and you see God's presence because there's no typical roof. And I always wanted to do a Sukkah project, and I didn't want to be in storage for 11 and a half months a year. And then we came up with this idea of that's where yoga takes place for 11 and a half months a year in this meditative space, and then all the walls come together and for 8 days becomes an outdoor dwelling. So if you're in New York, please come to visit it. I'm sorry, that was it. Okay.
Well, I think it's very telling that the thing you most wanted to do on your birthday was share about all your favorite pieces of art. So let's take some questions now.
Do you have one, actually quite a few questions, but we'll see how many we can do. An anonymous attendee asked, could you talk a bit about the role of faith, the void, in your painting?
Ooh, good question. Great question. Whoever that was, thank you. Love it. So I'm fascinated by the fact that you, the viewer, bring that space to life. I'm very interested in the dialogue between the artist and the viewer, and the void in the space I hope you as the viewer fill.
And your shrines, really.
The shrines are very much about that. I am very happy that the shrines, I started making the shrines in the late 70s. In fact, my thesis piece at Hunter College, I created a huge shrine to walk into, and I'm starting another very large shrine that you'll be able to walk into that's about how we're hurting the environment and about the idea that we have to understand what it means to be enclosed underwater. But hopefully within 2 years it'll be completed. So, yeah. I'd like to meet me. Then I go like, wow, that's pretty good. So I'm very close with Leonardo Drew, and we joke sometimes. And I was very close with Jack Whitten, too, I met for lunch for over 20 years. We taught on the same floor at SVA. And we would joke that when we would look at our paintings out of our studio, they looked so much better. So I know that somebody once said to me, I'd like to get a piece of yours. I don't really want to spend the money. Can't you give me one that isn't so good? And I'm going, if it's not so good, I'll destroy it. I mean, George McNeil, my teacher, who I loved, used to say always, you're known for the worst piece you make. And make sure none of your bad pieces ever get out of the studio. So, I love George. I love that. I don't know if you mind that comment. I love that comment because it always makes sure that if I don't think it's good, it isn't going to see the light of day. And yes, do I destroy a lot of work? Yep, I do. Yeah.
Hi. Right here, Sophie.
Oh.
Elizabeth, thank you for your presentation. There's something that you said that is inspiring me to now ask this question, so I hope you don't mind. How do you know that your piece is finished? What is that dot at the end that makes you feel? And I felt that there was, you took the relationship very close, and that's what I've been listening to. And it's kind of inspired me to think, when do you know that you are done? And more personal, if you don't mind sharing, is there like a special celebration that you do when you feel that you're done?
Well, I'm married to somebody for a long time, and I'll sometimes come home at night and I'll say, I ruined it. And she'll go, why don't you wait till the morning and look at it again?
And that's what I always do. I wait till the next morning. Unfortunately, sometimes I have ruined it, and then I have to start again, which is a drag. But sometimes I come in, like call Nessa in the morning, and I say, it's great, it's done. And so I told you, you know what I mean? So you know when it's done, and you know when you screwed it up, too. Sometimes you think you screwed it up, and you haven't. So then you're lucky. You know, you're very lucky. But my work is very labor-intensive. This gesso modeling paste, it's sanded. I am blessed with amazing assistants who help me do the stuff that I don't want to do anymore. But the last, 10 or 15 layers are glazing. And glazing are very slow-moving. And, you know, my hands turn whatever color the glazes are. But you know when it's done. I very seldom overwork anything. I often ruin things. That is unfortunate. But when it's done, it's like you feel like you want to make a blessing, you know. The act of making the work is my favorite part. When you see it in the museum, I'm thrilled and proud. I don't know if you know, there's a great Gorky, you know that Gorky thing that used to go to collectors' houses and want to rework the paintings, and they wouldn't let him bring his brushes in. I'm 99% sure it's Gorky.
Pete, I have this problem.
Oh, Pete, I know that. I know Pete, I did that.
Obsessive.
So if work comes back to my studio before a major museum show, I would love to touch things. I'll get you. Yeah, but yes, I don't want to give away anything else.
Yeah. Hi there. Do you feel like as an artist, you were talking about how the work throughout the years is the same? Do you feel like there's certain techniques that you like to keep using, or more so that you don't? You were talking about sandpaper.
I like translucent light more and more. I use more and more glazing. The underpainting has always been opaque. And now I really, in my sculptures, in my paintings, in my bronzes, I love patinas. I like things that if you give me 10 more minutes, you're going to get 10 more minutes of joy. My earlier paintings, I never think of them that way, but if you go upstairs, you'll see they're darker. Now they're more luminescent. I didn't think they were darker. Now that they're 30 years old, I still love them just as much. And we collect them. You know, we never had any of my work at home, and then my wife said we have to have some of my work at home. And I like sitting and looking at work of mine from the 80s and the 90s. And they've changed a lot, but I don't think they've changed because what I put into them is different. I see color differently now, and I like subtlety in color more.
Yes, okay. Besides being an artist, you're also a teacher. And teaching is, in some sense, about quality. And how is it that you teach your students about what is quality, what's good, what isn't quality, what's not good? Maybe in Vermeer's day, it was easier to say that, but now art is so diverse, and it's more difficult to say what's good and what isn't good. So what do you teach your students about that?
Be yourself. Don't try and be anybody else. You know, trying whatever you really believe, make sure your art shows that. Don't ever think about what everything's in right now because everything changes. I mean, nothing stays the same. If I taught somebody in 1980, I have students here for, now I'm so, this is a big thing for me. The curator for my next exhibition is here, who is my student at SBA. And she's an amazing glass blower. And, you know, I still remember the first day you came into class. And I think you've got to make the work that you really believe in. And don't think about what anyone else says. There's only one thing that, again, George McNeil used to say. If 10 people say you're drunk, sit down. But other than that, just follow your guts. Just follow what you believe in. You can never make a painting the same as the person next to you because he, she, or they came from a very different place than you did. And don't try and be somebody that you're not. That's what I tell my students. And put in an extra 10 hours. Whenever students come to me and say to me, we're done, I'm going, you're not done. And they go, yes, I am done. I said, but you're not. And they say, well, what am I going to do here? I said, sit there and look at it. And within a little time, they start doodling. And that's when it gets better. I
I think you have to really give everything of yourself to make the work strong. You had your hand up in the front here, so I don't want, yeah.
I'm going to get a little existential here and just go back to something that was brought up, which was around this idea of death. Klaus, I think it's deep, it's definitely existential. It's something that probably is as complicated as the Bible, but to dig into it a little bit, you know, this line between what happens in the studio and what leaves the studio, and what is in the studio initially and what it becomes after it leaves the studio, and the line between private one that may change the dynamics of what death means. So if you were to ask Tobi, I'm not putting words in his mouth, but there's an affirmation of life that goes on in terms of making it work. It's not always true with regards, but I think everybody's a little bit different. But I wonder if it's worth elaborating on that in terms of the multi-dimensional possibilities of what death means. In terms of, and also in terms of healing, you know, art.
Mm-hmm. So great art is as much about death as it is about affirmation of life. It's not a contradiction, necessarily. No, just like some of the major religions began after we were kicked out of paradise, and we had to die. So how do you create a meaningful existence with that? And I think art is one of the primary modes of giving people kind of this ethical foundation and this meaningfulness to exist. And you do so by living a good life, and so there is this affirmation of life in there. But you always, you know, but the notion that it is not everlasting is always present. All the people that were online, thank you so much for joining. I'm looking at everyone in the world, and all the people all over the world. I know there are a lot of people in California, in England, in Switzerland, and in Israel. I really want to thank all of you for joining today. It's the greatest present you could have given me. And you guys, Aaron and Klaus, and Debbie, I am telling you, I didn't know if I wanted to celebrate my birthday at all this year, because the world is in such a total mess, and I want to talk to all the people suffering in the world. You're allowed to think about two things in your mind at the same time. You can look at the fact that the world is not in great shape, but you should try and make it a better world. And not that this hour and 15 minutes does anything like that, but at least it's an affirmation of the fact that there are people. I know the three panelists very well, and they're all people that believe in making the world a better place. And I can't thank you enough for giving the hour and 15 minutes to hear about an artist's beliefs and thoughts. Mm-hmm. I just very briefly want to thank you, Tobi, on behalf of the Phillips Commission, for taking such an active role in guiding all these wonderful collectors towards our museum that made it possible for us to have this wonderful, you know, collection and unit of your work.
Thank you. Collectors, you're the greatest people that ever lived. I don't know what I'd do without you, and that's a fact. I mean, that is a fact. I've been blessed by being surrounded by people that have the same belief system as I do, and that belief is leave the world a better place. Every person who's here, thank you. Aaron, you're amazing. Klaus, you're amazing. Debra, I can't wait to get to know you better. She's a great writer. You should read her books. I've read them all. They're amazing.
Thank you.
Well, please consider joining at 4 p.m. at Wesley Theological Seminary, just up Massachusetts Avenue, about 2.5 miles up, where we're having a reception for Tobi, which will include our exhibition of 40 of Tobi's works, which is, as a biblical number, just means lots of lots. And so his great figurative works, so it's a great way to see an extension of the Phillips. And we look forward to seeing many of you there if you can join us. And otherwise, if you have questions for Tobi that you didn't get any chance to ask online, feel free to send those to me at arosen@wesleyseminary.edu, and I will forward them to Tobi, or we'll try to get back to you, because I know that that there'll be many other questions we didn't get a chance to tackle. So thank you, everyone, very much.
And I will sign any catalogs now if you'd like. It's an honor for me, and all the proceeds go to the museum. I've been blessed by patrons helping make these catalogs happen, and therefore I can never take any monetary from it. So whatever you pay for it goes to the museum. And the last thing I want to say, if you come to Wesley, you'll get amazing, delicious food. So, I know that people need physical nourishment too. It's great food. It's an amazing caterer in town.